Hi guys, welcome back to London. Today I'm on the bank of the River Thames. I'm starting on the bank of the River Thames. I'm just opposite the London Eye on the North Bank. I'm headed to an area of London known as called Covent Garden. Well, first of all, I'm going to head to an area called Seven Dials, but if you read guidebooks and look on maps, it's often described as part of Covent Garden. I think for most Londoners, when they think of Covent Garden, they think of the main square just down the road from Covent Garden tube station, and we'll head there. First of all, I'm going to head to Seven Dials. As I said, I'm going to get some coffee. There's a good coffee shop there and they sell coffee beans, and I've run out. So yeah, first of all, I'll head up to Seven Dials, which is the neighbouring neighbourhood, I guess, of Covent Garden itself. Then we'll head down through Neil's Yard towards the main piazza area, the main square of Covent Garden. And I guess Covent Garden's renowned for shopping primarily. So I'll share with you the main shopping streets of Covent Garden. What else is it renowned for? Food and drink and restaurants. I'm sure we can go somewhere to get something to eat or something to drink. It's also renowned for street performance. Now today, it's not the best day to do this. It's been snowing intermittently. I'm sure the street performers would perform in any weather. However, they're not going to perform unless the weather's good enough for people to stop and watch. So yeah, hopefully we can check out some street performers. The reason Covent Garden is renowned for street performance is they audition the performers. I mean, there are street performers and buskers all over town, but yeah, in Covent Garden, to perform there, you have to audition. They haven't turned that into a TV show yet. They've missed an opportunity. Popularity of reality TV and TV talent shows. They've missed a trick there. Maybe they have already, but I haven't seen it if they have. But yeah, so see if we can check out some street performers. It's also home to, it's probably the heart of London's theatre district. There's a couple of very large and historic theatres there, the Royal Opera House and the Theatre Royal, so we can go check that out. And yeah, a number of other landmark buildings, the old Bow Street, the old courthouse, and the old courthouse and police station, so we can go and check that out. Other landmarks would include, there's a couple of museums, there is Freemasons Hall. So yeah, we'll go and check out some of the landmark buildings of Covent Garden. But first up, I'm gonna head to Seven Dials, which is just next door. But yeah, as I said, most guidebooks consider it part of Covent Garden itself. But I'll talk a little bit more about that on the way there, and it'll make more sense when we get there. If there's some problems with focus today, just have to deal with it, like I was saying. I don't know if you can see it, but there's snow in the air, and there's undoubtedly by the end of this going to be some snow on the screen. But roll with it. Okay, that is Covent Garden down there. If you head down that street, turn left, you'll end up in the main piazza, the main square. However, as I was saying, I want to head up to Seven Dials, and I also want to do it by avoiding the crowds. Covent Garden's it's a very nice area to visit, and obviously hugely popular. So yeah, I'm going to head up this way. It will just be quicker and avoid the crowds, but the shortest way is that one, if you're heading straight into Covent Garden. I think Okay, again, if you're coming from Leicester Square is just there, Covent Garden, that is one of the main, that is the main shopping street of Covent Garden, Long Acre. So yeah, it's only, I'm gonna head 7 miles and then come back around. The area we're going to is actually north of, from the river, north of Covent Garden, but yeah, there were quicker ways there, but we need coffee. Okay, this is 7 miles, but this is one of the streets of 7 miles. Now, you haven't seen how busy the main part of Covent Garden will be yet, but the reason I came round this way is because I'm pretty sure it will be filled with people. So this area, it's a lot more relaxed, and smaller businesses, smaller, more independent stores, that will probably change. Yeah, I guess, as the rents change. It's definitely an area on the up. But yeah, bigger brands, bigger rents in the main piazza area. Whereas here, more small and independent businesses. But the reason it's called Seven Dials is the sundials. There are actually only six. They say the seventh is the actual column itself. The reality is, when they designed the street and built the column, there was to be six streets. But ultimately, they got seven. There is a reason for that. But if you want to know how to use the sundials, the instructions are on the side of the pub. I would imagine a prerequisite of using though is sun, which is in short supply. Okay, right. Originally, every apex of this street had a pub. There's only one left, the Crown. Right, let's head up Monmouth Street, get some coffee beans, maybe get a cup of coffee, and then head back down into the main piazza of Covent Garden.
Seven Dials, the seven streets of Seven Dials, were first laid out in the 1690s. As I was saying, originally the plans were for six streets converging at the central sundials. However, they managed to squeeze in seven. Seven Dials was intended to be a luxury development when it was built, but soon descended into one of London's worst and most notorious slums. It wasn't just Seven Dials, this whole part of London was a slum. Seven Dials was just a small part of it. It was the iconic Dickensian slum. Dickens visited himself and referenced the area's poverty in his writings often.
Okay, here we go. Monmouth coffee, queue out the door. Let's get in the queue, get some coffee beans and a cup of coffee. Okay, success. On the coffee bean front, got half a kilo of Kenya's finest. I didn't get in the queue for coffee. I've got things to do other than spend my Saturday queuing up for coffee. It is good though, it's worth the queue. But I'm gonna pop into Neil's yard here. Again, this is probably one of London's hidden gems. Got the big sign there. You can't miss the sign, but you can miss the entrance.
Neil's yard is named after Thomas Neil, who was the original designer and developer of Seven Dials. As I was saying, he had hoped for it to be a luxury development and attract wealthy residents. However, the surrounding areas descended into one of London's worst ever slums. No one wanted to live here. People had to live here. First off, Huguenots came in the 1700s, French Protestants fleeing persecution in France, and they settled here in large numbers. In the 1800s, they were replaced by large numbers of Irish immigrants, and that increased dramatically in the 1840s during the potato famine. Simultaneously in the 1840s, the authorities were trying to clear the slums and they built New Oxford Street through its centre, which only intensified overcrowding here in Seven Dials.
Okay, welcome to Neil's Yard. Very colourful buildings here, popular on Instagram. Plenty of places to eat and drink in here. Neil's Yard Remedies. Right, let's head down from here into the main part of Covent Garden and go and check out the main shopping streets. Okay, this is definitely one of the more popular shopping streets, Neil Street itself. Lots of popular brands, boutique sized shops, as you can see, and this street runs up pretty much to Covent Garden tube station, and then from there you can head down into the main square. Yeah, picking the main streets here is there are, I guess, three main streets: Neil Street, Long Acre, and Floral Street. But all of these streets, these shooting off the main streets, again filled with boutique shops, a lot of fashion stores, bars and restaurants.
Although today the streets of Covent Garden are lined with some amazing shop stores and boutiques, that wasn't always the case. A lot of the buildings here were once small workshops or warehouses. Once the clearance of the slums here began in the 1840s, either by development by the authorities or by deadly contagious diseases caused by the overcrowding, such as cholera, once the slums began to be cleared, businesses began to develop. And by the 1870s, the whole area was dominated by breweries, small workshops, and of course, the ever-developing wholesale flower market in the main square. And that was a trend that continued for the best part of a century until the 1970s, when the wholesale flower market was moved and then the retail shopping destination that we know today began to develop.
Okay, if you come to Covent Garden by tube, here is Covent Garden tube. Down there, very short walk, you can see them there, are the former flower market buildings. So the main square, the main piazza where you'll see the street performers. What I'm on here is another one of the major shopping streets, Long Acre. I'll head down here, just give you an idea of what's here. We'll head to one of the older shops, I'll show you that. Cut down the street that runs parallel with this, this little cut throughs to Floral Street. We'll cut back down Floral Street and then head down into the main piazza. Let's go. As you can see, although Seven Dials is considered by many part of Covent Garden, very different feel, much more relaxed up there, apart from the coffee shop, which was filled with people. But yeah, much more relaxed vibe up there, very busy down here, filled with visitors, shoppers, tourists. Okay, if you keep heading down there, you'll end up in Chinatown, then Leicester Square. Thought I'd come down this far to show you Stanford's.
Today, Stanford's is the world's largest and one of its oldest map and travel book stores. Edward Stanford established Stanford's in 1853, just down the road on Charing Cross. From 1873, this was the printworks. The retail store and the printworks were combined under one roof here in 1901.
Okay, I'm heading to Floral Street. I hope I can head into Floral Street. Down one of these little courts or alleyways, and then yes, I can. Yeah, so cut down here to the Floral Street, which runs parallel with Long Acre. It's one of the other major shopping streets, and then head into the main piazza.
If you're planning on going travelling, Stamford is definitely the place to get your maps and travel guides. Previous customers have included David Livingston, Captain Scott, Florence Nightingale, Sir Ranulph Fiennes, Michael Palin, even Sherlock Holmes sent Dr. Watson here.
Actually, I think one would do. This is the back of Stamford. I'm going to get a coffee while I'm here, and then we'll head down to my guests. So yeah, you can obviously enjoy a coffee while reading a book. I didn't know this was here in the queues. Much shorter than Monmouth's, although don't tell them. I better hide that. It's probably not as good. I'm not expecting it to be anywhere near as good as Monmouth. Okay. Takeaway coffee from Stamford's bookshop. As good as I expected. I definitely recommend Monmouth Coffee on Monmouth Street. Stamford's a great place to get books and maps. Right, let's head along Floral Street here and into the main part of Covent Garden.
To be fair to Stamford, the service was very good and it was actually great value for money for this part of town. If they walked up the road and got some decent beans, they could make a better cup of coffee, but that would cost more. However, there's a queue out the door for coffee at Monmouth and not at Stamford, so maybe that doesn't matter in this part of town.
Okay, before we head into the super crowds of the main piazza, Covent Garden itself, in front of me, is actually up. We're going to go in a big circle, but yeah, in front of me, not sure if you can make this out, but building on the corner there is the Royal Opera House. I'll show you that, one of the major landmarks here, and at the end of the street, that building there, right at the end of the street, is the former Bow Street Magistrates Court and police station. We'll be heading there, but rather than heading straight there, we're going to head down here.
Okay, at one end of this street behind us is Covent Garden Tube Station, and in front of us are the former market buildings, which are arguably the very heart of Covent Garden today. Covent Garden has a long history. It's documented in the 1200s to be the walled garden of the Abbot of the Convent of Westminster. This land would have been used by a convent of priests, monks and nuns as farmland. Fruit orchards were here, arable land to grow crops and pasture to graze livestock. The name changed from Covent Garden to Covent Garden by at least the 1500s. There's a lease from 1515 from Westminster Abbey which detail the area as a garden called Covent Garden. Covent, convent, they have the same meaning. So from 1515 and still today, the area is known as Covent Garden.
Okay, this in front of me, that's the main square, the main piazza of Covent Garden. Former flower market buildings, now boutique shops. As you can see, got street performers already, magician there, a human statue there, levitating. The main performances are in front of the church, in front of the main square. They're more like circus acts. Weather they'll be performing today, though, as I said earlier, the weather's terrible.
King Henry VIII, between 1536 and 1541, in an act called the Dissolution of Monasteries, disbanded Catholic monasteries, priories, convents and friaries and seized all their assets. He took all the land belonging to Westminster Abbey, including Covent Garden. His son, Edward VI, then granted Covent Garden to John Russell, the first Earl of Bedford, in 1552, and it remained in the Russell family until 1918.
Okay, let me give you a quick lap of the market buildings, and then we'll pop in and see what's happening.
In 1630, the fourth Earl of Bedford commissioned renowned English architect Inigo Jones to build the Covent Garden Square we're in today. The buildings in front of us are former market buildings and weren't constructed for a further 200 years in the 1830s. Originally, the square was open. Inigo Jones was commissioned to build the church, which I'll show you in a moment, and three rows of fine townhouses around this square or piazza. Although the layout and church remain, the original houses have been replaced. Inigo Jones introduced the classical architecture of Rome and the Italian Renaissance here to London. Covent Garden's design was based on the Grand Piazza of Il Vorno on the west coast of Italy. Although not a faithful reproduction, you can see the resemblance.
Okay. Quick lap is heading. It's a strange mix of street performance and very luxurious boutique stores. I can see here Dior, Burberry, Chanel, plenty of jewellery stores, and inside restaurants and the street market, effectively covered street market.
Once the aristocracy left Covent Garden for Mayfair and more fashionable neighbourhoods, during the 1700s the square here became home to coffee shops, gambling dens and brothels. And the market in the square, which was originally primarily fruit and veg, by the 1800s it had become chaotic and a wide range of goods were being sold here. So in 1830 the then owner, the 6th Duke of Bedford, secured an Act of Parliament to regulate trade here, which worked. And to make things even more orderly, he built these market halls in the centre of the square in 1830. They have been reconstructed and annexed over the years, and were very nearly demolished completely when the flower market moved in the 1970s. But here they remain, and today the shops and stores that were once used to sell flowers and plants are today boutique shops, bars and restaurants. The market here really flourished during the Victoria era and developed from fruit, veg and knickknacks. It grew into London's primary wholesale flower and plant market. So successful was the market, the space had become inadequate really by the end of the 1800s.
Okay. In this part, the smell of food is incredible. You can hear performers singing, but yeah, the lower ground there, there's seating and plenty of restaurants. Check it out. Okay, there's another lower ground on the other side. Same setup. There's a toy and theatre shop here, puppet store. The first showing of Punch and Judy in London was here.
Oh, how are you doing?
Hence the name of the pub, Punch and Judy's, and the theatre toy store. I guess you can get Punch and Judy's here.
There's a long history here in Covent Garden of theatre, opera and market, and historically that brought with it the strange mix of riches and poverty. You have the wealthy visiting the Theatre Royal and Royal Opera House, which I'll show you in a while. You have the rich mingling with the market traders and children dressed in rags. Charles Dickens describes the mix of rich and poor at length in Little Dorrit, describing Covent Garden as a place of past and present mystery, romance, abundance, want, beauty, ugliness, fair country gardens and foul street gutters, all confused together.
Spot of opera while you enjoy your Shake Shack burgers. Okay, let's head to one of the pubs with a balcony overlooking the street performers as they're performing. Punch and Judy's pubs, the entrance is just here. Let's head upstairs to the balcony. Okay, yeah, check it out. Entrance side of the market. All that's behind the door is a set of stairs. There's a bar downstairs as well. Balcony bar, we can check out some street performance.
Punch and Judy pub balcony has fantastic views, not only of Covent Garden's amazing street performers, but also St Paul's Church, which was originally built between 1631 and 1638. Designed by Inigo Jones, the landowner wanted a modest building. He asked for a barn of a church. Inigo Jones called it the handsomest barn in England, and we'll go and take a closer look at that later.
Better on a sunny day.
Pub histories are always long stories in London, and they love nothing more than to tell tales about how old they are. According to the pub, this was built in 1787 and it's a listed building. Maybe the underground cellar bar was. Paintings from the period just show wooden huts, and the rules of the market at the time were flowers and vegetables only, but the unauthorised sale of booze is well documented, so maybe there were cellars here. In short, I don't know which part of the building dates back to 1787. English Heritage do have a listing for the market buildings we were in, being built between 1828 and 1830. I don't know what existed before that besides wooden huts and market stalls, or what remains of it. Covent Garden Market was a flower market and didn't open as retail shops until 1980. And that's when the pub opened in its current incarnation in 1980. And it's called Punch and Judy's because the first record of Punch and Judy's puppet show being shown or performed in England was here in Covent Garden in 1662 and watched by Samuel Pepys. One thing for sure is we're in a very old historic building, nearly 200 years old, surrounded by buildings and a development nearly 400 years old.
Okay, that was Punch and Judy's. Easy to miss the entrance to that. Definitely recommend, it's a great spot to check out the street performance here in the main square in front of the church. They're heckling the performers, I guess, up there. They can't get roped in into the show, so they feel safer up there. They are good shows. Right, I'm going to show you some of Covent Garden's landmarks. If we head just down here and around the corner to Bow Street, yeah, Bow Street, show you the couple of the theatres and the old police station and the courthouse. Famous, I think it's only, well, it's the precursor to the Metropolitan Police, the police station was, and the courthouse is famous because of the famous people that were defendants there.
As you can see today, the main square, the main piazza of Covent Garden is pedestrianised. However, during its era as a flower market, you could drive up to and around the square and huge lorries from farms were delivering plants here. It was ridiculously congested. The family that owned the market sold it in 1918, and back then they even tried to sell it to the London County Council, but they didn't want to know. They described it as inadequate. The situation just worsened until the council did finally buy it and moved the market in the 1970s, but it was a disaster. The reason for doing it had reversed from primarily benefiting the market to primarily developing the area. They planned to flatten the whole place. There were petitions, councillors resigning, it was messy. Luckily the locals won, many of the buildings were preserved, the area was pedestrianised once again, and today it's taken many years to develop, but Covent Garden is once again what it was intended to be. A picturesque playground for the well-heeled that tourists and visitors to the area love spending time strolling around, shopping, eating, drinking and visiting the theatre.
Okay, before we head to Bow Street, that corner there is the London Transport Museum. Sadly it's not one of London's best museums, because London's best museums are free. popular museum, the London Transport Museum, is one of the things I have no issue with my taxes funding, my fares funding museums. It's not the case for everyone, a lot of London's best museums, all London's best museums are free. They just ask for donations. Well, when I say they're free, they're funded by the taxpayer. Right, let's head on.
At this end of Covent Garden, we're heading into the very heart of London's West End Theatre District. One thing people like to do both before and after the theatre is dinner and drinks. And there are plenty of restaurants and bars in this part of town to choose from, including London's oldest restaurant, Rules, which was founded in 1798.
Okay. This is Bow Street. The street that runs parallel with it, actually just pop down there. The street that runs parallel with it is Drury Lane, which was, much of London has had changing fortunes over the decades and centuries, and apparently Drury Street down here was once one of London's most fashionable streets. But yeah, this is another one of London's famous theatres, Theatre Rock. The entrance is actually now here on what we're on, Catherine Street, but there's been a number of theatre royals on this site, and some of them had entrances on Drury Lane.
We're in the very heart of London's theatre district here. London has a very long history of theatre, but all theatres were closed in the 1640s. There was a civil war and they banned all pastimes considered frivolous until 1660 and the restoration of the monarchy. In 1660, King Charles II granted two chaps permission to form new theatre companies. They started out in converted buildings. One was called the King's Company and the other the Duke's Company, and they had a monopoly on shows considered serious drama. All other theatres could show at the time was comedy, pantomime and singing and dancing by law. Ultimately in 1682 the two companies merged. The King's Company was in the Theatre Royal here beside us, and after a number of years and a number of moves the Duke's Company was in what we know today, just up the road, in what we know today as the Royal Opera House, and they were competing with one another just down the road from one another. In 1663, the King's Company opened the first West End theatre here beside us, the Theatre Royal, and there's been a theatre here ever since, and it's been visited by every monarch to reign ever since. It's been demolished and rebuilt, and this is the fourth theatre built here, which opened in 1812.
Okay, this is Drury Lane. Mainly residential properties now, a few shops. The back of the Theatre Royal now. Was traditionally, traditionally one of London's more fashionable streets. Also, I think the first, once down one of the first, if you're not from England, J. Sainsbury's. Sainsbury's is one of London's biggest supermarket chains, and the first store was on that street somewhere. I actually live in one of his first stores myself, in the townhouse above. That's a whole nother story. Right then, let's head back and check out the Bow Street Police Station. See if we can cut down the back here. Bow Street Police Station, Magistrates Court and Royal Opera House. Show you the Royal Opera House. Having some renovations done. Well, I suppose you can see the main foyer.
This is the third theatre, the third Royal Opera House to be built on this site. The first was constructed in 1732. This one was first built in 1858 and has undergone considerable refurbishment since. Today it's home to the Royal Opera and the Royal Ballet, both of which you can see perform in a video on my channel about Covent Garden at Christmas. I'll put a link to that at the end for those of you that haven't seen it.
Okay, this behind me here, we're on Bow Street, and this is the former, you can see it's all boarded up.
This police station and courthouse was completed in 1881, but Bow Street has a much longer history for law enforcement. The first court opened in 1740 and its constables, the Bow Street Runners, formed in 1749. They were considered the first professional police force and a precursor to the Metropolitan Police.
Okay, yeah. I was interrupted by the ambulance. Bow Street Police Station. Is there a sign above the door?
This was the entrance to Bow Street Police Station.
And then, on the corner here, for the Magistrates Court, Bow Street Magistrates Court. I don't know what the plans are for that building. I would imagine it's got hotel written all over it. There's another one up at the end of former courthouse at the end of Carnaby Street on, is it Marlborough? Marlborough Street, Marlborough Lane, I forget the road that Liberty is on. There's a former courthouse there. That was made famous because the Rolling Stones were ended up in there for one reason or another, and yeah, it's now a hotel, and you can have dinner in the old courtrooms.
A few famous names have appeared in court on Bow Street. Casanova appeared in court on Bow Street, accused of hurting a pretty girl. Chilean dictator General Pinochet. Famous London gangsters, the Cray twins. Charles Dickens reported cases from courts, and Oscar Wilde's gross indecency trial was held here.
So yeah, former magistrates court. Probably one of the most Instagrammable streets in this part of town for the phone calls. Looks like someone is sadly moving into that.
Check out this bronze statue of a ballet dancer. It's called Young Dancer.
Okay, well, we're at this end of Covent Garden, Bow Street, and the Royal Opera House there. The ambulance is back. While we're at this end of Covent Garden, take a quick right and so show you another one of the landmarks here, the Freemasons Hall. Actually worked for Freemasons for many years. Never got to the bottom of secretive handshakes and whatnot. But yeah, the hall is here. For a secretive society, it's a pretty ostentatious building. It's actually, I believe it's a memorial to Freemasons that died in the, in the First World War. Maybe I'll narrate this bit.
Okay. The Freemasons Hall is the headquarters of the United Grand Lodge of England and the Supreme Grand Chapter of Royal Archmasons of England, as well as a meeting place for many Masonic lodges. It's been a Masonic meeting place since 1775. There have been three Masonic buildings on the site. The current one opened in 1933, and it was built as a memorial to the 3,225 Freemasons who died on active service in World War I. It was originally called the Masonic Peace Memorial, but they changed the name to Freemasons Hall at the outbreak of World War II in 1939.
Okay, yeah, I don't think you can make it. Off the door, 1914 to 1918, so I guess I was hopefully right. So yeah, Freemasons Hall, available for private hire these days. It's the multiple movies and award ceremonies and plenty of events these days. Right, let's head back into, I've done a big lap, let's head back into the main part of Covent Garden. Maybe we'll finish off in one of London's more historic pubs. Okay, on the way, I've got to give one of Covent Garden's pubs an honourable mention. Cross Key. I'm not going to go in. I'll go in the other one, but I'll show you where it is. It's just down here. Cross Keys, very popular pub with locals. It is a great pub, can't go wrong if you're looking for a traditional British pub. Hop in there, but I'm gonna head to a slightly older one. Unpopular with the tourists. Yeah, probably find more locals in there than you will in this one. But let's go. That way. Okay, this here on Rose Street. This little street just off of Garrick Street, just down the road from the main piazza of Covent Garden. Yeah, just here on Rose Street is the Lamb and Flag public house. But I've never ever heard anyone else in Britain call a public house, they are the pub.
Now, as I was saying earlier when we were in the last pub, London's oldest pub is a list of disputed short stories rather than a list of comprehensive facts. The Lamb and Flag here on Rose Street, well, Rose Street here was constructed in 1623. It's one of the original parts of Covent Garden's development, and a timber frame building would have been here originally. The building here now in parts dates to around 1688, according to English Heritage, maybe earlier. The pubs say 1638. Definitely had some work done over the centuries, and the brick front was completely rebuilt in the 1950s. It's been recorded as being a pub as far back as 1772, according to the pub, and has been called the Lamb and Flag since 1833, making it one of Covent Garden's oldest pubs and certainly one of London's more historic boozers. Famous drinkers have included the writer Charles Dickens, and also poet John Dryden was attacked here in 1679, and they have named a room after him upstairs. Good service. Good beer. Okay, it would have originally been probably at least 3 bars. You can see from the beam there, the door we came in, it would have been a saloon bar, probably a lounge bar at the back, public bar at the front. Yeah, it's so busy, it's been smashed into one. You still see the beams from where the partitions would have been. Dining room's upstairs. Apparently the Lambman flag had the nickname the Bucket of Blood for some time because it gained a reputation for boxing outside on the cobbles. Bare knuckle prize fighting, which was pretty brutal as there were no rules until 1743, and the Marquess of Queensbury's rules as we know them today didn't come about until 1867. Public bare knuckle boxing was a popular sport here but effectively outlawed in 1882, and from then on boxing became either more organised events or more private ones. Today the Lambman flag is a more friendly place and they serve a great choice of beers in the bar, and they're sitting on the first floor to enjoy some food.
Okay. Definitely recommend the side door. The Lambman flag. It is a great pub and a historic pub. The irony of that is it being a historic pub, one of London's older pub, makes it one of London's famous pubs. And that makes it, as you could see, incredibly busy. Which means you probably won't get the quintessential British pub experience. Most Brits go to the pub. The rugby's on in there today, so there are a lot of Brits in there. It's not full of tourists watching the rugby. However, most of the time, if the sport's not on, Brits, Londoners, during the day like it is now. I mean, obviously Friday nights and Saturday nights are different, but during the day, primarily head to the pub for a drink and I guess chaps for a chat. Ladies to gossip. So yeah, maybe somewhere less busy than that, like the pub I showed you earlier. But okay, I hope you enjoyed this this trip to Covent Garden. Maybe head back into the main piazza. Yeah, I hope you enjoyed this trip, this little tour of Covent Garden. Covered the major shopping streets, best place to watch the street performers, and some of its famous landmarks. But I would definitely recommend a trip here. The area has had a roller coaster of mixed fortunes over the centuries. Originally developed as a luxury residential development, as was Seven Dials. Deteriorated into a slum, and once again it's back in business and on the up. Through my lifetime, it's the brands, the stores, the market has definitely been becoming more and more luxurious, home to higher ticketed brands and stores. But anyway, as I was saying, hope you enjoyed this trip here. So until next time, from Covent Garden, toodles. Before we leave Covent Garden, I'll give you a quick walk through of I guess a spot most people may not visit, but a popular spot for locals at lunchtime, a peaceful spot. Churchyard. Incredible statue.
St Paul's Church is part of the original Inigo Jones design for Covent Garden. It's been here since 1633, and as well as performing its duties as Covent Garden Parish Church, so baptisms, weddings, funerals and praying, it squeezes in an incredible amount of events each year, concerts and theatre performances, and the churchyard back here is a popular spot with locals to take a quiet break from the hustle and bustle of the main piazza. I would imagine a lot of the people that work in the shops and stores probably take their breaks here.
Okay, I'm sure a lot of people are very, very familiar with the other side of the church because of the performances. The actual entrance is back here. And yeah, popular, peaceful spot for people to sit, enjoy a drink or bite to eat at lunchtime. Obviously, popular spot on Sundays as well. And yeah, St. Paul's Church and the church. Okay, from Covent Garden,
Toodles.
Definitely recommend a trip here. Guy's about to do what he calls the sandwich of death. Yeah, I definitely prefer the circus shows to some of the others. If you want to see the sandwich of death, you have to pop to Covent Garden yourself.
Theatre at the end of the show. I will be standing just here with my hat.